Addresses the essence of our own promise, the promise that is America. The question that our distinguished guest has posed and proposed to answer is whether we have, with the inauguration of President Barack Obama, ushered the dawn of a post-racial age.
I used to have a distinction, I still have it, between coup-prone countries and coup-proof countries. And coup-prone countries are those which have military intervention in politics every so often, and coup-proof countries are those who have avoided that since independence. I'm relieved that that includes my own country in East Africa. We haven't had a coup yet in Kenya, touch wood. And then there are a number of other countries here like Senegal and Tanzania. And then the coup-proof countries, the coup-prone countries include Nigeria and, for a while, Ghana. The first test of whether you're getting out of coup-prone country is when you succeed in changing governments, throwing out the incumbents in the teeth of their own opposition, and having a whole new political party in power. If it happens once, you are encouraged. If it happens twice, you are on your way towards coup-proofness. In Ghana, it has happened twice. And for that, we thank the Lord, and we thank Ghanaians for giving us a good example. I've been fascinated by the whole Obama phenomenon, and I've been working on it academically, and not just in terms of comparing it with my own country and claiming him as a compatriot from Kenya. But one of the issues raised by the Obama phenomenon is this business. Are we entering a post-racial age? Can there be such a phenomenon as a post-racial society? So a post-racial society is one which has not only abandoned racism as a form of bigotry, but has also shed off race consciousness as a residual form of defining groups. So a period of national history can be tribal, pre-tribal, tribal, and post-tribal. Why can't periods of continental history also be either pre-racial, racial, or post-racial? So all the countries with a white majority population, the one which earliest allowed a man of color to rise to the pinnacles of at least one aspect of life was not the United States. It was Russia, and it wasn't communist Russia. In general, we probably don't realize how significant it is, and I will later just touch upon the simple fact that, with effect from January 20th, Barack Obama became the most powerful black person in the history of civilization. That never before had there been a black person with access to so much power. So he's therefore greater than Shaka Zulu of Southern Africa, Menelik II of Ethiopia, is greater than Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Your Excellency. In Othello, we have a black man addressed as my lord by a white woman in the bedroom. We see him kissing her after murdering her. Yet the play's villain, Iago, is the one the audience is invited to despise, if not to hate.
The natural enemy of the white man is now perceived to be less and less a person with a different skin color, and more a person with a different religion and values. Barack Obama's prospects for the U.S. Presidency were helped by the predisposing shift in the nature of prejudice in American society.